Folks at home, welcome back to the Crimson Oak Pond, and if you're new to this series, we built this 5-acre pond over the past year, and it took us several months to get all of the dirt excavated, and we had to bring in several truckloads of clay, and we also built an island, a dock, and got all the structure in place, and then it took a couple of months to get it full of water. After that, we stocked it with a bunch of bait fish, including bluegills and threadfin shad. And not long after that, we stocked it with these little 2-inch aggressive bass. And it's hard to believe that it's already been a year since we stocked the bass in the pond. It seems like it was just yesterday we were putting them in. And I knew they had some really aggressive genetics because when we were acclimating them to the pond water in a 5-gallon bucket, they were fighting over the little minnows that we were dropping in. And over the past year, I wanted to document and learn as much as I could about them. So each time I caught one of the fish, we installed a pit tag in it to be able to track its growth. And I also set up cameras in every possible area so we could get a better look at them. We had underwater cameras. At times, we would fly the drones and get aerial shots of them, or some would call it the bird's eye view. But one of my favorites was the nighttime feedings under the green lights. I also added more food than they could possibly eat in threadfin shad, bluegills, tilapia, and at times we would even experiment with things like prawns. And when we first started catching them, they were about this size. And here in the past couple of weeks, we had our first bass weigh in at over 2 pounds. So I'm going to be sharing a lot of interesting information I learned about them over the past year. But before we do that, we just completed a really cool project I got to show you guys. So most of you that watch this pond series are familiar with a 150-year-old oak tree that got blown over by a hurricane right before the pond build. And I wanted to do something special with a piece of the wood, so I decided to build a 3D resin table and carved the shape of the pond into the wood. But not only that, I also wanted to show the contour lines and different depth changes throughout the pond, as well as all the structure that we put in the pond before filling it up. Because we put a lot of unique features in there, like a feeding trough, a shade shack, and one of my personal favorites, the oak throne. And I knew that the talented Mr. Nate Makes was the perfect guy to build this table for me and collaborate with. Because not only did he get a first-hand look at a lot of the structure that we put into the pond, but he's also extremely talented when it comes to woodworking. And Nate spent about 5 months building this table, and he's got the full video uploaded on his channel, but I wanted to show you a couple of the highlights. You can see here, he's carving out those contour lines and showing the depth changes. And I was extremely impressed with the amount of detail that he put into making the structure of the pond. He used 3D and resin printers, and handcrafted and even painted every single piece of structure that was in the pond. So at this point, he's placing all that tiny structure in the pond before he fills it with resin. You can see we've got the tunnels and all the oak wood piles we put in, as well as the dock and the oak throne, and then followed up with the resin pour, which can be a pretty difficult process, but he executed it perfectly. And since we're engineers, you knew there had to be some kind of electrical components, so he added a controller to help automate some of the lights. But one of the coolest parts about this project is we wanted to duplicate the green lights that I installed underwater out here near the dock. And I never had any doubts in Nate, but he by far exceeded my expectations with this incredible table build. Check out those green lights. That's amazing. He even added the Crimson Oak Pond logo, but the level of detail and structure placement just makes this entire project amazing. The topo and contour lines show you those depth changes and probably where a lot of the fish are hanging out. And if you get in close, you can even see the individual boards on the dock, as well as all the wooden structure pieces having limbs. And it's just next level when it comes to details. He even included one of those last minute additions of the prawn pond. So I give the table a 10 out of 10. I couldn't have imagined anything better than this. My hat's off to Nate. And not to mention, the bottom half of the table is pretty impressive as well. He enclosed it in a glass case that was a perfect fit for the dueling bluegills that Liz and I caught a few years back. You can see they're battling over that worm. And even got the original Bama Bass logo carved into the bottom. So what I've shown you is just a tiny glimpse of the table build. So guys, do me a favor and go watch the full video on Nate Makes' channel. I've got a link down in the video description. He's got a new channel, so give him some support and tell him what an incredible job he did. And also, he's going to be doing a giveaway of a smaller version of this table. All the details are in his video. And over the past few weeks, the bass have started schooling up and patrolling those shallow parts of the pond, looking for the baby tilapia. And I got some really cool footage of that with a drone. But before we get into that, a quick message from today's sponsor. And today's video is brought to you by AG1. And if you're not familiar with them, AG1 is a nutritional drink that includes vitamins, probiotics, and whole food sourced nutrients that aid your brain, gut, and immune system. And as many of you know, Liz always has a garden planted for us out here at the farm, and we always do our best to eat a healthy diet. But AG1 is a perfect fit for when we have those busy schedules and don't always eat like we should. And it helps provide sustained energy with nutrients that support physical and mental energy, as well as improving your digestion with pre and probiotics. And it also provides immunity support with a blend of essential vitamins and minerals. And my AG1 kit came with a 30-day supply, a mixing bottle, a canister with a scoop, and some travel packets. And it's very simple. You just mix one scoop with 8 to 10 ounces of water. Mix it up, and it's ready to drink. And I like to drink mine early in the morning, especially if I have a long day ahead of me at the farm. And they also include these travel packets that make it easy when you're out traveling or on the go. Each of them includes one scoop that's ready to mix. So if you're interested in checking them out, click the link in the video description, and it'll give you a free one-year supply of vitamin D3 plus K2, as well as 5 travel packs with your first purchase of AG1. So do me a favor and go check them out, folks. So I've been playing around with a new drone that I got, and not only does it have great video quality that allows you to capture some pretty cool angles of wildlife out here at the pond, but my favorite feature about it is it has 3 different built-in cameras. And one of those is a long-range camera, which is huge for my style of filming. And the reason for that is because it allows me to get really high up in the sky, but still get that really detailed up-close footage. And the reason I bring that up is because in the past, when I'd fly around with my old drone, all the bass, bluegills, and other fish are naturally scared of those flying objects because it reminds them of ospreys and eagles and things that like to attack them. So up until now, I never really could record the bass in their natural environment without spooking them. So I've spent a lot of time flying this thing over the past few weeks, and I really have learned a lot about the bass. And for those of you not familiar, we stocked the pond with tiger bass, which is a 50-50 breed between a northern aggressive bass and a Florida strain bass, which is not so aggressive, but they get bigger. And in some of these clips, you'll really be able to see that aggression come out, but this is the first time I've been able to see them school up together. And my best guess is right now, the tilapia are spawning, and there's a lot of young baby tilapia swimming around in the shallow water. So it's really fun to watch them team up, and in some cases you'll even see them work together, enter one side of the tunnel while the other one swims around to the other side and traps them in. But one thing I have noticed, and something we'll be talking about in depth later in the video, is that this aggressiveness that these tiger bass have is good and bad in a way. So some of these tiger bass are constantly swimming around the pond, schooling up and chasing these smaller fish. And while they probably eat more doing this, they're also burning off a lot of their energy. So it requires a lot more food for them to get big. And if you compare that to something like 100% Florida strain bass, they're most likely going to get around a piece of structure and sit there really still and wait on their food to come to them and exert the least amount of energy possible. So if you're a future pond owner, the type of bass that you put in is really up to your preference. I prefer the more aggressive tiger bass, and you should be able to catch them more frequently. But the one trade-off is it may take them longer to get big, and you're probably going to have to feed them more. And speaking of feeding them more, if you missed the last video, we used a cast net to start catching some of the prawns and feeding those to the bass. And as I mentioned in that video, the idea behind feeding them the prawns is it doesn't require as much food. On average, a bass has to eat 10 pounds of forage food to gain 1 pound. And by forage, I mean your typical bluegills, threadfin shad, tilapia, and things like that. Well, there haven't been many studies, but one study shows that a bass would only have to eat 7 pounds of prawns to gain 1 pound. And that's because they're much higher in protein, even when compared to a crawfish. So if you ever put a shrimp and a crawfish side by side, a shrimp has a lot more meat in it. So that's why we're going to experiment with the prawns to try to boost their weight up. And speaking of their weights, my overall goal was to have the tiger bass gain 2 pounds per year. And that doesn't mean every fish in the pond, because the females are always going to outgrow the males. But I wanted some of those females to get up around that 2 pound range. And so far we've only had one cross it at 2.11 pounds. But we've had several females in that pound and three quarter category. So for this upcoming year, one of my goals is to put as much weight on the fish as possible. And the one thing I have noticed is right here around that 1 year mark, they are becoming a lot more aggressive and feeding in schools, and that's something that they used to not do. And if you'll pay close attention in some of these nighttime feeding clips, the target size of minnow or shad that they're chasing is really small. And you can only imagine how many of those tiny shad it would take to make 10 pounds of forage. That's probably hundreds, if not thousands. And that's been one of the intriguing things to me, is that the tiger bass could eat fewer bluegills and wouldn't have to eat as much. But up until now, they've basically been preferring those smaller style minnows. And that's probably because that's what they started out eating with those fathead minnows we stocked in the beginning. And later in this video, I'm going to show you some footage. It's almost like a light switch went off over the past couple of weeks, and they decided that they were now big enough to start eating some of those bluegills. So I got some really cool shots of that coming up. So that is another positive sign that they've matured enough to eat the bigger size forage fish, and that should also help make up some of their weight percentages this next year. And so it's been a while since I've seen this guy, and look who finally showed back up, one of the owls that we call Hooter. This owl's probably gotten more screen time than any other wildlife out here at the farm because they were here at the very beginning of the pond build. So happy to see him back. If I had to guess, they were probably nesting or taking care of their young somewhere. But now they're back to chasing the field mice. So I was out setting up some night lapses the other night, and this little guy almost scared me to death. I thought I saw a ghost walking, but it's Mr. George Jones, the possum. And this guy's in rough shape. He's about lost all his hair now, so he just looks like a little white ghost floating around. And even with my camera lights on, I'm not even sure he could see me, or maybe he just doesn't care. But you can't be sneaking up on me like that, old George. All right, time to show you our latest project. So my buddy Nick built this birdhouse for me, but the cool thing about it is it's got a built-in nesting cam. He also built a little sunroof in it right there. That's pretty cool. But the idea is that the birds will build their nest down here on this bottom flat spot. And anytime there's motion, I'll get an alert and I can check in and see what kind of yellow belly rumper's making his nest. Another cool thing is it's got a solar panel right here, so that'll keep that camera charged. All right, I got the front cover put on. He even has a little landing stick right there for him. So solid job, Nick. Can't wait to see what makes it a little nest in there. Now, while we're on the birdhouse topic, I hadn't ever seen any hummingbirds out here, so I wanted to do something to draw them in. So I got a little hummingbird house, got the dual feeders on it, got them some nesting material down in there. So let's see if any hummingbirds will make a new home out here at the pond.
Out here filling up the fish feeders today, and we'll give you a quick feeding so you can see some of those piranha bluegills. So we had a good bluegill spawn this past year, and I'm not sure if you can tell, but a lot of these bluegills are the smaller variety, which is really good because those initial bluegills that we stocked in the beginning before the bass have already gotten too big for the bass to eat, but they'll continue spawning, and that's basically just a self-sustaining food source for the bass. But this is the feeder that all the action's been happening at. And initially we stocked it with the tiny starter pellets because we were feeding the fatheads and small bluegills and things like that. Well, I had it shut down for a couple of months and I decided to experiment with some of those larger pellets. And let's just say it was a very successful experiment because not only is it feeding a lot of different variety sized bluegills, but for some reason this part of the pond attracts more of those bass. And as I mentioned earlier, this is the first time that I've ever seen the bass interested in coming up and eating the bluegills. And it's basically like an easy meal for them. We set these feeders to go off 3 to 4 times a day. And even I was surprised by how many fish came to the feeders the first time I flew the drone over the top. Not only does it bring the shallow bait fish in, but even those out in that deeper water will come up for a few seconds right after the feeders go off. And I personally like it better when the fish are hanging out in the shallow water because obviously I can see them and film them more and learn a lot more about them. And that's another reason we didn't build the pond too deep because I didn't want all the fish to go out and sit down on the bottom in the deep water and us never be able to see them. And this is one of those bass that just doesn't want to miss out on a meal. When everybody else is eating, he thinks it's time for him to eat. So he's just over here patrolling. Not really wanting any of the other fish to come eat their food, unless he's eaten. But you'll also catch some birds and other wildlife hanging out around the feeder sometimes. I'm sure they have no idea what's going on when the feeders go off. And even got a little close-up of the ducks. Alright, time to check in on Moby in the backyard pond and do some fish feeding. And we had several questions about where we get our golden shiners from, and that's Anderson Minnow Farm. You can buy them online, they ship them overnight, and we usually have about 95% of them alive and healthy when they get here. So now let's take a quick underwater look and see what's going on today. Got the whole gang hanging out right in front of the camera. Even got the turtle coming over to say hello. But not a lot of action underwater today. Even getting some yawns out of Moby. Everybody's just been pretty laid back. And in case you didn't know, the fish 100% know when you're filming them. And they always come up and get that up-close facial shot. And another funny clip where we got the two turtles fighting over what they think is a piece of food. All right, it's time to go tag some bass, or if we catch them and they've already been tagged, we'll use this to scan them, see how much bigger they've gotten. Not really sure what they're going to be biting in this heat, so we'll start off with a topwater frog. That's probably my favorite. And then go a little deeper if we have to. That's a good blow up right there. Right here at dark. Man, this fish is putting up a good fight too. It's a good one. Frog eater. Yes sir, that's what we're talking about right there. That's a nice fish. Let's see if this one's been tagged. Has not been tagged. Alright, this fish is 14 inches. And his tag is going to be 569736. Days. 1.67 pounds. Man, talking about that was right at the dot. Aggressive little guy. All right, this fish has not been caught before. He is 13 and a quarter inches long and is going to be 570827. Got him in at 1.25 pounds. Yes, sir. Yeah, that's a good stocky fish right there. All right, this fish has not been caught. 15 inches. It's gonna be 571094. Weighs 1.78 pounds, almost another 2-pounder. All right, that's a nice one. Got him. That fish went airborne. Gotta love it. It's a nice one. All right, hadn't been caught. 14 inches. This fish is 570134. And it weighs 1.54 pounds. All right, back out here at the half acre food plot, putting out some more antler magnet. I'm gonna see what comes out tonight. Roasted corn, soybeans, and peanuts.
So we're starting to get a lot of deer activity. Some of it in the middle of the day, but most of it in those low light situations, early in the morning or late in the evening. You can see we even got George and one of the raccoons thinking about squaring up. Even though George is getting old, his nose still works good because he's always able to find the food. And as you can see, all the bucks are in velvet. It's a fun time of the year for me to start seeing how their antlers are going to grow out. And you can even compare some of them to the bucks from last year. And sometimes their antlers will grow back in the same shape, but maybe a little bigger. And you can pick them out from last year. But I thought this was pretty neat. We had our first raccoon baby. Only got one little clip of him. But he seems to be having a good time. Now we're out here checking in on some of our summer crops. We got a lot of seed producing variety out here. And so basically I'll come through and mow strips of this out, and all of that seed on the ground will attract doves and other wildlife.
All right, out here at the dove field, and one good way to get extra doves flying in is to set out some decoys. So we're getting a few of these set up. That just gives them the confidence to fly on in. But last year, every time I came out, we had our decoys knocked over, flipped upside down with dents in them,
And come to find out, the foxes and coyotes were after them. So we got a game camera set up. We're going to see if anything comes out tonight or maybe late this afternoon and messes with the decoys.
And now that we got the long-range lens on the new drone, we can spy on some more of the wildlife. There's one of those raccoons, and you can see a big herd of deer coming out right at dark. And if any of the wildlife were going to bust me, I just knew it would be the deer because in the past, I could never fly a drone around deer without spooking them. They're just too loud, and the amount of air that they displace, it's just not something that wildlife naturally sees. But with this drone, you're so high up in the sky, it probably resembles something like an airplane and doesn't bother them at all. We got a big full moon tonight, so it's a perfect time for a night lapse, but I wanted to take a second to ask you guys what type of content you would like to see over the next couple of months. We got another big project coming up in November where we're doing an aquascape pond build and turning the prong pond into an aquascape pond. But until then, I've got some free time to explore new ideas or start a new project, so just leave any comments down below on something you'd like to see, and I'll do my best to get to it. Now that the sun's coming up, let's see who's stopping by. And it looks like a couple of our pet ducks making their way around the pond, looking for a snack. And now it's time to feed Mr. Tiger. And he's one of the original bass that we stocked in the 5-acre pond. So this upcoming year, we got the same game plan for him. We're going to try to put as much weight on him as possible. We just recently moved him into the 300-gallon tank, so he's got room to grow. So he's going to get a heavy dose of these golden shiners, and we'll try to catch him up to his pond mates. All right, folks, that's going to wrap up this video. Now's a perfect time to go click that link in the video description and check out Nate Make's full video of the table build. But make sure to hit that subscribe button, and I hope y'all enjoy this one, and we will see you all next time.